Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming today. I'm Simon Rosenberg from NDN and the New Policy Institute. We have a wonderful program, and just to give the agenda for today, we will be focusing on this idea of a 21st century border with Mexico. And we have first a speech by the Secretary of the Department of Homeland Security, our old friend Janet Napolitano, to be followed by a very distinguished panel that will take us to about 11:15 or so. So for those of you who want a full morning of discussion about this important matter, we're going to have meaty conversation all the way to about 11:15, so please stay with us. For those of you who don't know, NDN and the New Policy Institute is a think tank that has a particular view of the world, which is that there's a new politics being born in America and in around the world, driven by three big changes. First, here at home, great demographic changes that are changing the people of the United States in a way that's perhaps unprecedented since the arrival of the Europeans here in the 15th and 16th century. Second is that media and technology are fundamentally changing the way we do just about everything in our lives, right? How we communicate, advocate, organize ourselves, govern, how we conduct commerce, how we talk to our friends in ways that are profound and, frankly, accelerating. Third is that the challenges we face as political leaders in the 21st century are just fundamentally different than what we faced in the 20th century. The great big change, the thing that is really in many ways the hook that is making things so different, is rapid globalization that is causing change in geopolitics, the rise of countries like Mexico, Brazil, and others, but is also changing our country here at home. And so these three big changes, demographic changes, changes in media technology, the governing agenda of the 21st century, our argument is that a new politics is being born here in the U.S. and around the world, and that what think tanks, the NGOs, the outside communities need to be thinking about is how do we reimagine a politics that allows our country and our civil societies to succeed around a whole different set of global and domestic circumstances. That's what we do here at NDN. And what perhaps no more important for us in this analysis of where the world is going is what's happening with the rising domestic Latino population in the United States and the rise of Latin America as it begins to stand up, adopt modern economic strategies. We've seen rapid growth in Latin America, pluralistic democracies, and Latin America itself is changing. And what it's going to require in the U.S. is a reimagination of what Latin America is, and particularly our neighbor to the south, Mexico, and what our response is to these changing circumstances. So what we're here to talk about today is part of that reimagination, this thing called the 21st Century Border Initiative, which was signed there was a declaration signed by President Calderon and President Obama last year when President Calderon was visiting. It was a very far-sighted way of reimagining how our countries could look at perhaps the most important part of the relationship, which is the border itself between our two countries. And just a few statistics before I turn it over to our keynote speaker today. First, when you think about the border, I think there's popular imagination right now sees it as a dangerous place. I think the opposite is true, right? It is the busiest border crossing in the world of any two countries anywhere in the world. There's $1 billion of trade that goes across the U.S.-Mexican, that goes between our two countries every day, making Mexico today the third largest trading partner of the United States of any country in the world. Third is that our population here in the United States is now 10% of Mexican descent. The ties between our two countries, family, commerce, cultural, are only going to deepen over the 21st century as our own population changes and requires us to have a different relationship with our southern neighbor that will be dictated by the people here in the United States. And so I think the opportunity that we have going forward is to begin to understand how these set of fundamental changes, the commerce that is growing, the trade that is increasing, the cultural ties that are beginning to bring our two countries together, is that we have to then use that understanding to reimagine what the border itself really looks like. And what I'm very proud of to report today is that the strategy that has been deployed to make this border a safer, more dynamic region is working. And we're going to hear about today is perhaps one of the greatest success stories, frankly, that is least known of the Obama administration so far, and certainly of the remarkable Department of Homeland Security. So to discuss the progress that we've made, the vision of this 21st century border, the new way that we can imagine how our two countries work together to solve common challenges, it is my great honor to introduce Secretary of the Department of Homeland Security, Janet Napolitano. Thank you, everybody.
thank you, Simon, and thank you to the NDN for hosting this important gathering, which is really designed to speak to the 21st century vision for the border between the United States and Mexico. To get to the actual facts about what has occurred and is occurring along the border and the progress that has been made over the past 2 years. And that will continue to be made because I'm not standing before you to say that our work is done and we're moving on to something else. The border and our presence at the border and how we deal with the border, both from a security standpoint and a safety standpoint, and from a trade facilitation, a commerce facilitation standpoint, that is ongoing work. Most of it seated within the Department of Homeland Security. And so the efforts that the administration has put in with an additional assist from the Congress, and I'll get to that in a moment, have really allowed us to make significant leaps forward and create a border zone and think of it as a border region that is open for business and that needs to be open for business, not just for the economy of Mexico, but for the economy of the United States. While I'll not be staying for the conversation, you're going to be hearing from some individuals who know intimately what actually is happening in this area. You'll hear from the Deputy Commissioner of the CBP, Customs and Border Protection, David Aguilar. You'll hear from the head of ICE, John Morton. You'll hear from the head of Citizenship and Immigration Services, Ali Mayorkas. You'll hear from Al Zapanta. You'll hear from Mayor Krieger, all of whom have significant firsthand knowledge of the border, of safety and security along the border, of immigration patterns along the border. You name it, they know it. They live it every day. But let me offer some remarks to help frame the conversation from the outset. We have, I think, fundamentally changed the country's approach to border security and immigration over the past 2 years. And as Simon said, we have significant, tangible, measurable results to show for it. And this leads to this statement, and it is it needs to be a realization in the United States and in Mexico that American border communities are safe, they are open for business, and it's important that we say that. Why? We have communities along the border. This means thousands and thousands of jobs in the United States and a huge market for products made in the United States. Now, I know this border very, very well. I was raised in a border state, New Mexico, and spent most of my adult life in Arizona until I was brought back to Washington to be a part of the cabinet. And I did not just live in Arizona. I was the U.S. Attorney for the District of Arizona. I was the Attorney General of Arizona and the Governor of Arizona. And in that capacity, dealt with border and immigration and trade-related issues virtually every day. I have walked that border. I have flown it. I have ridden it on horseback. And I have worked with border communities from Brownsville to San Diego now for the better part of 18 years. So I speak from a lot of personal experience as well as looking at the overall numbers, the metrics, the things that we need to judge our progress by. Now, I also want to say that in addition to our efforts at the border, we have made serious and significant strides with respect to the enforcement of our immigration laws on the interior of our country. And that's important because there is some connection between those two things. And so prosperity in the border region, security in the border area, a 21st century vision for the border, coupled with immigration enforcement within the United States, that is the system, that is the framework that we have developed. Now, the border is simply not the same as it was 2 years ago or even 1 year ago in terms of manpower, resources, and technology. And in terms of the relationships we have built with our federal, state, local, tribal partners along the border, and in terms of what we are doing with Mexico itself, particularly with the Calderon administration. This is not to say we don't still face challenges. We are, and I am, deeply concerned about the drug cartel violence in Mexico. And I think we have to acknowledge the serious nature of the battle that is going on in Mexico with respect to the cartels. We are providing as much assistance to Mexico as they have asked for, but we know that these drug organizations are seeking to undermine the rule of law in the states that border the United States, the states of northern Mexico. And that is an issue for us, as well as guarding against spillover violence of the type that we have seen plague Mexico these past few years. And I'm not, so that remains a continuing challenge and a continuing concern. And I'm not here to run a victory lap about the numbers, because while the numbers are significantly better, and it's time for the American people to understand that the investments we have been making along the border are producing significant and tangible results, we have to continue to make those investments, and we have to continue to sustain those efforts. But I think the amount of resources we've put at the border with Mexico shows how serious this administration is. So, and given the deployment of resources, given the statistical framework, it is simply inaccurate to state, as too many have, that the border with Mexico is overrun or out of control. This statement, I think sometimes it's made to score some political points, you know, but it's wrong. It's just plain wrong. And continuing to make these assertions in the face of everything that's happening and everything that's been done not only has negative consequences for our own border communities, but it also it disrespects the significant efforts of the law enforcement men and women we have put down on that border, who work every day, day in and day out, to make sure that we do have a safe and secure border region. And we not only have a safe border region, but we keep it that way. The reality is that many of our country's safest communities are actually at the border. And violent crime rates in border communities have remained flat or have actually fallen in the past few years. We have seen improvement in all statistical areas when it comes to border enforcement. But the misperceptions that are out there, and it's a lot easier to say the negative than the positive, but those misperceptions are hurting. They're hurting cities like San Diego and El Paso. They're hurting communities like Nogales, Arizona, who live on, work in, and need jobs in communities along this side of the border. So the mayors themselves in that area of the country, and you'll hear from several later today, have actually joined together to say, look, enough is enough. Damaging misinformation about border communities has been repeated so often that it's almost become a given in American life. Everybody says, oh, the border's out of control. It doesn't work. It's not safe. It's not secure. And that means for them they can't recruit businesses there. It means the colleges can't recruit students there. You name it, they have after effect after after effect after after effect. So while we know we continue to face big challenges at the border, while we know we continue and must continue to sustain our efforts there and be a constant presence along that border, it is important again to say, and I'll say it again, that the border is open for business as well. So if I might, let me give you a few of the facts about the resources deployed on the border and the efforts made to facilitate legal travel and trade and to enforce our nation's immigration laws over the past 2 years. Now, we knew at the beginning of this administration that we needed to put a framework around the border, to look at it in a fundamentally different way, and to look at it as not only a law enforcement issue, but also a commerce and job creation issue in the United States. In March of 2009, we launched the Southwest Border Initiative. We increased the size of the Border Patrol to more than 20,700, more than double the size it was just a few years ago. We doubled the personnel assigned to the Border Enforcement Security Task Forces. They're called BEST teams, which work to dismantle the criminal organizations that occupy areas alongside the border. We increased the number of ICE intel analysts along the border who are focused on cartel violence. In fact, right now, 25% of ICE's personnel are actually located right on the southwest border, the highest percentage ever. We quintupled deployments of border liaison officers to work with their Mexican counterparts. Again, it's a border. It's a relationship between two countries. It is a line, but it is also a relationship, and a lot has to happen there with our counterparts in Mexico. And we began screening southbound rail and vehicle traffic, looking for the illegal weapons and cash that help fuel the cartels. With the aid of a $600 million supplemental appropriation that the administration requested and that a bipartisan Congress passed in the summer of 2010, we have continued to add technology and manpower and infrastructure to the border. This includes, within that $600 million, 1,000 more Border Patrol agents. It includes 250 more port officers at those very important big ports along our border. It means 250 more ICE agents to focus on transnational crime. It means significant improvements in our tactical communication systems. It means at least two more new forward operating bases to improve coordination of our border surveillance activities. And it includes adding CBP unmanned aircraft systems. In fact, we now have, and this is for the first time in U.S. history, we now have Predator unmanned aircraft system coverage from along the entire southwest border, from the Gulf in El Centro sector in California to the Gulf of Mexico in Texas. The president authorized the deployment of 1,200 National Guard, and we announced $150 million in Stone Garden funds in 2009 and 10 to help local law enforcement along the border do its job and to pay for things like overtime. And of that $150 million, $123 million of that went to the southwest border states. So a significant add to particularly the sheriffs and the cities and police chiefs in the small cities along the border, who oftentimes don't have the tax base necessary to cover some of the operations they need to cover. These are only a few of the things, but taken as a whole, when you add them all up, it is the biggest surge of manpower and technology to the southwest border ever, and it represents the most serious and sustained action to secure that border in our nation's history. And every key metric shows that that approach is working. Border Patrol apprehensions, which is an indicator of how many people are trying to cross illegally, down at least 36% in 2 years. Name me one major American city that has had that kind of decrease in crime rate in the last 2 years. Seizures of contraband are up in all categories, illegal drugs, illegal bulk cash, illegal weapons, all substantially up. And as I said before, violent crime in our border communities has actually remained flat or actually fallen. In fact, the statistics show that these are among the safest communities in the United States. Now, as I mentioned, we've coupled that with interior enforcement, particularly of our nation's immigration laws. And we have based that enforcement on a sound prosecutorial principle. And I say this as a former prosecutor. You have to set priorities. And you have to say, what's our goal? What are our top cases? What do we want to make sure we focus on? And we have been focusing on those in the country illegally who have also been committing other crimes, who are really impacting the public safety of the United States. And so while in the last 2 years we've actually removed more illegal immigrants from the country than any 2 years prior, something that I think the public should recognize. And half of those are people who have committed other crimes as well. And as we continue to deploy a system called secure communities, that percentage of removals who are actually those who are also in our criminal justice system will only go up. In addition, we have increased or changed the way we do worksite enforcement. We really don't and stop the process of just doing the raids that generate perhaps numbers and good news stories, but didn't get at the real culprits here. And those are the employers who intentionally, knowingly go into the illegal labor market to hire their workers, oftentimes at the expense of jobs for those in the country legally, and oftentimes under conditions that were exploitive and paying wages that were far below minimum wage. So now what we do is we have greatly expanded the audits we conduct of employers, and when we find that they're not maintaining their I-9 paperwork, or they're not using E-Verify or some of the other easy-to-use processes that are in place, systems in place, then we can send in investigators to really give them a thorough investigation. So audits to investigations. What does that mean? It means we can cover far more employers, and it means that we can begin creating that culture of compliance in the employer community that we must have. Our employers need to abide by the nation's immigration laws, because the primary draw for illegal immigration into this country still remains labor, jobs, work. And so we have to get at those employers who fuel that demand side of the equation. So border enforcement sustained, substantial, ever-increasing over the past 2 years. Every metric going that needs to go up, going up. Every metric that needs to go down, going way down. Coupled with, I think, smart interior enforcement practices and policies. And then we need to move to the trade part of the equation, because this progress on security has helped us to expand our commitment to promoting the flow of legal travel and trade. And this is a top priority, as I mentioned before. So we, through the Department of Homeland Security and also the GSA, the General Service Administration, have dedicated about $400 million to modernize the infrastructure at ports of entry along the southwest border in the last 2 years. I mean, these are big ports. Those of you who know this border know what I'm talking about. Lots of trucks need to get through there. Lots of vehicles need to get through there. Wait times need to be sustained or shortened if that border is really to work. And many of our ports were too small, didn't use cutting-edge technology, were far out of date based on the amount of commerce we needed to support. So $400 million worth of port infrastructure improvements in the last 2 years. I mentioned that Congress last summer included funding for 250 more port officers, that was great, but if and when Congress gets to an FY12 budget, if and when they get to that FY12 budget, they will find that the president has actually asked for 300 more. Because the manpower necessary to work those larger ports and to move that traffic along needs to be increased. In addition, we have added technology and K-9 teams, other things I've mentioned. But the improvements I've just mentioned, more port officers, port improvements, and the like, has already shown itself in the numbers. The total value of imports crossing the southwest border into the United States in 2010 was 22% higher than the previous year, 22%. And the number was up 40% in El Paso. It's also up in Laredo, in Nogales, and in San Diego. So commerce is going up. The community violent crime rates are staying the same or going down, and all the other metrics are, as I say. But let me close with this. Two thoughts. One, I think it's important that we constantly be taking the temperature within our border communities themselves, that we not just rely on somebody on TV or somebody on the floor of the Congress or in the heat of a political campaign, not even just rely on what I would be saying, but constantly taking the temperature of our border communities themselves. And when you speak with people who live in the border, not those that are volunteering themselves for the cameras, but others, they'll tell you that they know the change. They see the change. They feel the change. And they know that this is a key priority for this administration. And we will sustain this change and this progress over the next years. But I don't want to end this talk without one last point, and that is as follows. The border is important for our country, but so is immigration reform. And I say this as somebody who in the 90s supervised the prosecution of well over 6,000 immigration felonies myself. I know that side of the equation as well. And we can't keep moving the goalposts and saying, well, when the border is whatever, we'll get to it. The president has asked the Congress to consider immigration reform at a bipartisan level. He has laid out an outline for what an immigration bill should look like that is comprehensive in nature and that recognizes that our nation is a nation of laws and a nation of immigrants, and these things do not have to be mutually exclusive. And so that challenge remains. And in a world where there are lots of challenges, this is one that is so very important that we not let slide or neglect with the press of other business moving forward. So the president is open for the Congress to come to him with their ideas for what a comprehensive immigration reform proposal would look like. And we will continue to work with the Congress on how those kinds of changes could be implemented as well. But in the meantime, I think it's an important message to send that we are not tarrying. We sat down from the beginning and said, we want a safe and secure border zone. We want it all the way from San Diego to Brownsville. We want effective modern ports that can move traffic back and forth. We want effective control between the ports of entry, realizing you can't seal that huge geographic area, but effective control between there. We want smart immigration enforcement in the interior of our country, and that is, in fact, the package that we have been delivering. Thank you very much.
Madam Secretary, thank you so much. We are very fortunate to have the opportunity to take two, three, maybe four questions if they're fast and quick. And I think the way we're going to do this is where is the...
Can we stay at the podium?
Yeah,
that would be good
for the cameras. Yeah, that would be great. Okay. And Hillary, who's here, please raise your hand, and we'll try to get to you. And Hillary is the Sherpa. Please identify yourself if you can. And keep it quick, if we can. We'll start here, right here. Yes, sir. Please, with the mic.
Joe Onick, the Rabin Group. Madam Secretary, you mentioned the priorities in prosecution. I note that at the beginning of the administration, Attorney General Holder announced that the Department of Justice would not prosecute medical marijuana users in states such as California. And I wonder whether this administration... And you could now announce that it will not prosecute young men and women who meet the requirements of the DREAM Act.
Well, I think You know, a number of us in the administration worked very hard on the DREAM Act to get Congress to pass that at the end of the lame duck. And sadly, it passed the House, and as you know, it failed by 5 votes on cloture, meaning it had 55 votes in the Senate, but 5 votes short of 60. I'm not going to stand here and say that there are whole categories that we will, by executive fiat, simply exempt from the current immigration law, as sympathetic as we feel towards that. But I will say and can say that, you know what, they are not that group, if they truly meet all those criteria, and we see very few of them actually in the immigration system, but if they truly meet those criteria, they're not the priority. And the reason we set priorities is so that the focus could be on those in the country who are also committing other illegal acts. And so I'm sure that answer does not satisfy you. I can see you shaking your head. I think the Dreamers put the human face on the cost of not really looking at the immigration law as a whole.
Yes, sir. Right here.
Santiago Tabara from Notimex. Have you talked to human rights groups about the impact of the deportations in families? Some people are saying that people are being deported to Mexico in areas where, there is high crime, and the organized crime is present there. So, and also your reactions on the Arpaio's, Sheriff Arpaio's use of aircraft to control immigration.
I'm not going to respond to what Sheriff Joe may or may not be doing. On the deportation issue, we have been working with Mexico on an agreement for interior repatriation. And that agreement is awaiting signature, is my understanding. And we hope we can get that signed very shortly. The panel is up, they can talk in more detail about where people actually are being deported to. We are very cognizant of the potential impact on communities. That's why one of the reasons we're working so closely with our colleagues in Mexico about that.
Right here, and then we'll go.
Pablo Sanchez from Univision. Madam Secretary, are you implying that there is an economic cost that we're already feeling about the border communities in terms of the negative impact of the publicity that has been generated about their insecurity and the possibility of high crime rates?
You know, when you talk to the business people in those communities, that's why I say you got to get below the folks that are volunteering to be on the cameras. But they usually have a point of view, and they're going to say, what that point of view is. Now you gotta go down below and actually talk to the business owners, the people that are involved in economic development efforts, those individuals, and they will tell you almost uniformly that they're having a hard time because they're constantly fighting this image that somehow this is an area of the United States where the rule of law is not being enforced. And I will tell you, as the former chief federal lawyer and chief state lawyer for the state of Arizona, probably the hottest state where illegal immigration has been concerned, that the rule of law is being enforced, will continue to be enforced, and you can see it in every metric, that every number I've given you. And so that perception is so oftentimes so difficult to fight perception with reality. One of the purposes of today's discussion, I believe, is to begin to really ask people to think again and to really look again at this region, particularly in light of the huge surge of men and resources over the last 2 years.
Maybe two more. And if I can come here, Hillary, down here, this young lady right here, if we can get... If you can somehow squeak into the second, Patrice, pass it down. Thanks, Patrice.
Thank you. Secretary Napolitano, Antonia Takais with La Opinion newspaper. Yesterday, Congressman McCall called for an initiative to categorize Mexican cartels as terrorist organizations. You have said several times that Mexican cartels are a problem for the security here in the United States. Do you think it's the right call to call them terrorist organizations? And second, you said that the administration is ready for Congress is ready to receive proposals from Congress on immigration reform. Why is not the opposite? Why is not the administration the one that goes to Congress and said, here is our proposal, let's work on this?
Well, I think the president already has done that. I mean, he's already given the Congress the framework. He's already met with bipartisan members of the Congress. He's talked with a number of Republicans in particular, because you need a bipartisan coalition to actually get this done. But he's not received anything back. And so at a certain point, they have to pass the law. They're the ones that he can't introduce a bill. Congress has to introduce a bill. They've got to debate it. They've got to pass it. But he has already given them the framework for such a bill and his willingness to sit down at any time when they are ready. He's already met with them, called them, spoken with them, and I know that because I've been in many of those meetings. And I make a practice not of speaking to the merits of any particular bill that's introduced, because introduction of a bill is such a preliminary part of the process. So I'll just leave it with the point I made, which is the cartels are serious for Mexico, and they're serious for us because they have distribution fingertips that reach into communities across the United States. I didn't say that. I said I'm not commenting on that bill.
So maybe we'll take one more, and then, Madam Secretary, if you have any closing thoughts, how's that? Because I know you're under a tight time schedule. Yes, please, in the corner here, Patrice.
Hi. Elise Foley with Huffington Post. I was wondering if you could respond to some of the criticisms of secure communities, given the number of non-criminals that it does pick up. I've read as many as a quarter of the people picked up in secure communities are never convicted of a crime. I was wondering if you have any response to that criticism and or any plans to try and change that.
Well, we have, first of all, let me explain what secure communities is, because I think there's been a lot of misunderstanding about it. Here's what secure communities is. When you're arrested and you are booked, your fingerprints are taken, and they are run against the FBI's various criminal databases. What secure communities is basically an agreement between ourselves and the Justice Department that they will also be run against immigration databases. And if you do it, and you have to do it for everybody who's being booked. You don't just do it for some who are being. Everybody gets fingerprinted. Whoever gets fingerprinted would be run through both systems, and we are now that system. And I make it sound easier than it is because you got to link the technologies and all that kind of stuff. But it's basically in 1,000 jurisdictions now, including every single jurisdiction along the Southwest border, and it is one of the primary tools we now have to actually carry out the priority we have set, which is to try to find those in the country illegally who are committing other crimes as well, or who are a danger to public safety. Now, you have to recognize it's a new system. I mean, this, the growth from 0 to 1,000 has really been over the last 2 years. And so the numbers are still early numbers. And you will not capture in those numbers, for example, those who are still in prison serving their terms. The most serious offenders, they're not out yet. So they're not showing up as a secure community number. So the percentage of low-level or non-criminals that you quote is really not, in the end, over time, going to be that percentage. And we know that in a number of jurisdictions, when they are dealing with some individuals, They will basically give them time served in jail and then send them to secure communities. And it looks like there was no crime committed. But when you actually go in and look at the arrest file, why were they getting fingerprinted to begin with? There was a crime there. And oftentimes, then, sometimes you look further and you see something that is ranked as a very low-level crime when you actually look at the file. Well, that's what was charged or pursued. But the actual behavior or record of the individual is actually more extensive. And so it's important in secure communities to take numbers and then look below the numbers. But here's the important point. We know that. And one of the things I want to make sure secure communities is not is a conduit for racial profiling or for local law enforcement inappropriately seeking to be immigration officers, right? That's not what secure communities is designed to do. And so we have now retained our own statistician, and we have within our department a civil rights unit that is working with ICE, who administers secure communities, to make sure that we are collecting good data, that we're constantly measuring data so that we can begin to identify if at least from a statistical standpoint, a number standpoint, if jurisdictions look like they're out of whack. And that would give us the thought that we need to go in there and actually look at the arrest files, read the police reports, and the like. And so it's, I think, important for us to make sure that we do that even as we expand secure communities. But there were a lot of criticisms raised against 287G, which was the a prior statutory mechanism that was used. And it turns out the secure communities, because it applies to everybody and because of the guidelines and the rules that attach to it and how it can be used, I think meets many, if not all, of the concerns that were raised to that earlier enforcement regime. And so I know John Morton is here. He can talk a little bit more to that perhaps on the panel. But first, it is a good tool. That's all it is. It's a tool. Second, it is now getting to the point where we can actually start capturing data. But people need to understand the data that's coming out now is only preliminary, and we need to get below the data to really understand. And third, we want to do that because we want to make sure it's being deployed and operated in the right way in the United States. And with that, I'm feeling the hook. Let me just say, you all have been great listeners here, and I appreciate that because so many times when you're talking about immigration on the board, people get really, people get really have very passionate feelings, and that's important. But it's sometimes important to listen, particularly when change has been as substantial and as rapid as it's been over the last several years. I applaud you all because you have been listening, and that is something I hope that we can continue. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So we're going to take just a 5-minute break. That's it. We're going to end with this distinguished panel. We're going to get going. I know that some cameras may be leaving. Some folks need to go to the restroom, but be back here 5 minutes sharp. Thanks, everybody.
off camera.
There are TV interviews going on here, right? Okay, we'll go. Folks, we're going to, if you could take your seats, we're going to begin in just a minute. Thank you very much. It would be great for you to touch upon that. Because you know progress is made. If we cut funding now, it's going to have. Al, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good. Appreciate that. So welcome back, everybody. Thank you for staying with us for what will be a deeper dive on the subject matter that was raised in the speech today by Secretary Napolitano, which I would like to summarize as tremendous progress has been made, but there's more to do. And I think that that's a fair way of characterizing what's been going on along the border. I think there's a lot of reason to be pleased and happy, and also recognizing, as she said, the enormous challenges ahead as well. But certainly we should acknowledge the progress that's been made. With us today is a remarkably distinguished panel of people with tremendous expertise. How we're going to manage to get all of this into an hour, we will do our very best, and all of us will be very disciplined in our remarks and our comments, so we can hear from the breadth of knowledge in this, on these issues that we're going to hear from in a minute. What we're going to do from a format standpoint is just move from my right to my left, and we're going to start, and let me just do incredibly brief introductions, and we'll get right to it. Is first, we're going to hear from John Morton, who's the director of the U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement Agency, a recognized leader, long career civil servant who's been working on these matters for a very long time. We will then be hearing next from Ali Mayorkas, who is the director of the U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services. Then following Ali will be David Aguilar, who's the deputy commissioner of the U.S. Customs and Border Protection Agency. I was fortunate enough to be with Alan Burson, who is the commissioner, just on Wednesday, and was in a meeting with the mayors of El Paso and San Diego and Tijuana, Mexico, where much of what we just heard was reinforced by the mayors actually living and dealing with the border region. We're next going to be hearing as a representative of this new border mayor organization that's been set up to try to create greater awareness of the success of these initiatives along the border, Alan Krieger, who's the mayor of Yuma, Arizona, who we're very fortunate has taken time and flown all the way up here today from Arizona. And then finally, we'll be hearing from Al Zapanta, who's the president of the U.S.-Mexican Chamber of Commerce. A remarkable group. We're all fortunate. We'll be spending about a half an hour listening to some opening comments from our panel, and then hopefully we'll have time for about 30 minutes of structured Q&A. So what I'd like to do is begin by welcoming John, and John, please take it away.
All right, well, thank you very much for inviting me. Happy to see many familiar faces. I'll keep my remarks extremely brief, so I'm sure most people have questions at these kinds of things. I tend to get more than my fair share in strict mathematical terms. A few things about ICE. I mean, I think we tend to be misunderstood as an agency on many levels, and that's largely because we are viewed in the public eye almost exclusively in terms of civil immigration enforcement in the interior, even though the agency itself has a mission and jurisdiction that is much, much, much broader than that. People tend not to get past the immigration in ICE and not to the customs part, so there's the whole customs side of what we do. And then even within immigration, it tends to very much focus on the interior, although, as the Secretary noted, a quarter of our personnel are right on the border, and over a third of our personnel are in the four states along the southwest border. And we are very much a border security agency. It's a central part of what we do. We have offices in 47 countries overseas. In fact, we have the most overseas offices of any component in DHS by a long shot. So we're very cognizant of the strong relationship between the interior, between the border, and quite frankly, with the countries to our north and south, and that good enforcement can't be viewed in a horizontal fashion based on a line between Brownsville and San Diego, but rather vertically in dealing with securing flows north and south primarily. And in most instances, those flows are tremendously positive, things that we want to promote as a country, want to ensure occur on a grand scale. And that's the lawful travel of people and goods. And then there are other flows that we want to deter and stop if we can. And that is the illicit flows of people and contraband. And that's very much the way that we approach matters. It's very much the way CBP has been approaching matters, and I think we are working together along the southwest border with CBP at a in a way that we have never done before in our history, and the same is true with Mexico. I've never seen the level of candor and cooperation in the relationship be as strong as it is now. That's not to say there aren't challenges from time to time, but our relationship with Mexico is the strongest I've ever seen it. So with that, I will pass it on to the good director of CIS.
Thank you, John, and thank you, Simon, for hosting us. I'm very proud of the work that we at U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services does. We have a lot of work to do to honor the principles of our nation's immigration system, which is to unite families, spur economic growth, and provide humanitarian relief to those in need. With respect to the work that we have ahead of us, I am here to answer whatever questions you might have and to hear the concerns so that I better understand what the agenda is that lies before us. I have a clear understanding from extensive engagement with the communities that we serve, but each day brings new lessons, and I welcome the opportunity to hear and to respond. Thank you.
Go ahead, Dan.
Hey, good morning. As you said, my name is David Aguilar. I'm the Deputy Commissioner for CBP. And first, I want to thank the Indian for inviting us to be here today. I think it is a tremendous opportunity to speak to the state of the border. What I will do right now is just give you a very quick snapshot, because I think who we really want to hear is from the mayor here, who actually lives on the community day to day and is very interested in what is happening on that border. But very quickly, there has been a lot done on the border, more to do, but a tremendous amount of success when we take a look at the situation that we face on the southwest border currently. A couple of statistics, because I think people tend to move to statistics to tell a story. But if we go back to 1992, places such as San Diego, Tucson, El Paso, and McAllen, four of our major cities along the southwest border. Since then, those cities have grown tremendously. Through 2009, violent crime in San Diego has fallen by 20%. In Tucson, it has fallen by 17%. In El Paso, has dropped by 34%, and 7% in McAllen. In McAllen, the population growth has gone up by 33% since that time period and 23% in El Paso. The growth rate has been tremendous. The violent crime drop has been tremendous also. Now, we have doubled the size of the Border Patrol, over 17,500 Border Patrol agents along the southwest border. We have built fences that give us the persistent impedance that we require in order to enforce the borders. We have added a tremendous amount of technology and are continuing to add a tremendous amount of technology. One of the things that we don't talk to often enough is the partnerships, the relationships, and the liaisons that we do have that Director Morton just talked about, not only with each other domestically, but very critically important with our Government of Mexico partners that are undertaking a very heroic effort. If somebody had told me as recently as 5 or 10 years ago that this is the relationship we would have today with our Mexican partners, I would have found it hard to believe. But it is absolutely at the highest level, at an unprecedented level of effort between both countries. And that is what it's going to take to make it even better along our nation's southwest border. Now, having said that, let me just close out my portion with the following. And that is that we protect our borders to protect the flows of people, of trade, of commerce, in order to maintain the safety of our nation and to ensure the economic vitality and economic competitiveness of our commerce and trade with one of our closest trading partners. Thank you.
Mayor? Good morning. Thank you, Simon, for this event, and I appreciate the invitation. I am Al Krieger. I'm the mayor of Yuma, Arizona. And Yuma, Arizona is a unique community in that the sector of Yuma is the only sector in the United States that has a controlled status. And it has been accomplished by if comprehensive was ever a word that could be used, it would be there, a comprehensive approach to border security. And not sealing the border, but dealing with the issues that impact the border in a way that are reasonable yet effective. Funding is absolutely a key to that border security. Funding to ensure that we have secure, safe cross-border traffic, goods going back and forth, people are safe going back and forth, and there that movement is expedited in a way that the national security of the United States is held in integrity. And our community is approaching 100,000 people in the city of Yuma and close to 200,000 in the metro area, including some of the other smaller communities. 30 to 40,000 people cross that border in vehicles or on foot every single day. A large majority of those are agricultural workers. And I have talked to a number of people in Washington here about creating programs, a little bit of out-of-the-box thinking, programs that would work in Yuma, that would not necessarily apply in El Paso or other areas, to facilitate those workers to cross the border. And that's the out-of-the-box thinking that we need, local control. I was glad to hear that Secretary Napolitano is encouraging input from the locals. What is really happening on the ground and how we can solve these problems. Yuma, Arizona works very, very closely with our neighbors. All levels of law enforcement in our community work hand in hand. We have a system called radio interoperability that was designed by our current city administrator that connects every level of law enforcement agency, even the school resource officers and water district people, with a radio that they have that puts everyone on the same channel. Now, that has allowed us to react to incidents and things like that in an effective way. The turf battles that you hear about between maybe cities and sheriff's departments or police departments simply does not exist in Yuma, Arizona. And that has been key to our success. We are all on the same team. And we have to adopt that mentality and find a way to work together on things that will work and not focus on the things that aren't working. My message here and the message of the border mayors is to override that negative message that hits the national media that everything is in chaos on the border. That's not true. Our lives go on. agriculture goes on. Every bit of lettuce that you folks are eating today comes from Yuma, Arizona in the winter. And it's good lettuce, good product. But that it is grown and harvested by people that cross that border, packaged and shipped all over the world. We have one of the largest military installations, Yuma Proving Ground, and the Marine Corps Air Station is the busiest Marine Corps Air Station in the Corps, right 20 miles from the border. So we live, work, we have 60 to 70,000 winter visitors come down to Yuma, Arizona every year. But when we get the calls, about the third question is, what about the border? How safe is it? Because they're listening to a national message that is inaccurate. And I'm here to tell them that that's not accurate for Yuma, Arizona. I'm not in denial, nor are any of the other border communities, about the challenges that we face with the drug cartels. It's real. It's dangerous. And that is another reason why I'm here, to ensure that the funding has to continue. It's extremely important that those Stone Garden funds, they're proven, they work. But we have to have that funding. We also need that funding to continue and actually increase to get the infrastructure on our borders. We have a new commercial port in Yuma, but our old port, where the vehicle traffic and the pedestrian traffic is, simply is inadequate. So I'm glad to hear that the president is coming up with a plan to build our infrastructure. This is going to put people to work, and our unemployment rate is over 23% in Yuma, Arizona. It's tragic, but I can't afford to let the overriding message of border wars simply rob us of an economic opportunity to create jobs. So I want to tell business, I want to tell Chamber of Commerce, industry, that Yuma, Arizona is safe, secure, and ready for business. And that rings true for a lot of other communities. We're not in denial, but we want to make sure that Washington understands that we're needing help. And I want to touch on this just a little bit. In Arizona, we're not bad people. We have some challenges with our legislature, no different than you would on a national scale. The boycotting and all of the things that go on, you know, what would we all boycott simply because IRS comes out of Washington, IRS law or EPA? It doesn't make a lot of sense, honestly. So America has got to get on the same team, simply like every other community does. We have to work together and solve these problems. So I'm thankful that I was invited to this panel here to answer some questions about what the reality is in Yuma, Arizona. The reality is we're suffering economically, but we're tough. We're going to find a way through this thing and work with every level of agency, work with our neighbors to the south, and find ways for them to help them get out of this challenge with a number of issues that they have, too. Thank you.
So, Al, I have a question. Is that we've heard that, you know, Mexico, we know today, is one of the fastest-growing economies in the region, that trade is increasing. There is extraordinary amounts of traffic back and forth every day. Is the border open for business?
Yes, it is. And it, as the mayor so eloquently stated, that's exactly what's going on. First of all, let me thank you, Simon, for having a very important forum here today and for your insight in having a young man that worked with me 8 years ago, Christian Ramos.
So, thanks for training him.
Yeah, well, we did a little bit. You may have to retrain him. yeah, I want to say something real quick, and this will be something many of you will understand. I always like to eventually get to a point that says, you know, my family, like many families that may be in the audience, the border didn't just happen. And I like to say the border crossed our family. We didn't cross the border. In other words, we were here before there was a border. Let me tell you why I say that. My mother was born in El Paso. My father's family settled Tucson. First sheriff of Cochise County Mayor was Bustamante, who's one of my great-great-uncles. On my Mexican side, the general of the north of Pancho Villa's army, who raided Columbus, New Mexico, and was hanged for it because they served him up as a political, you know, offering to Pershing, It doesn't change wherever you are politically. His name was Esteban Rodriguez, General of the North. I'm a Californian. Great-grandfather was born in Sacramento, Alta California, and his name is Siegfried Holling. He's a German engineer, a mining engineer. So that's really the border. That's our country. That's our history. Now, let's talk about business. That's who I represent. You know, the critical piece about this is that the economic driver, it what drives the relationship. It's people, goods, and services that cross the border every single day. And I have to tell you, I've seen what CBP has done. I've seen what ICE and CIS has done and the mayors. They are doing a job that really is almost, it's a thankless job, but they're dealing with it and it is getting better. And I will state that very clearly. I remember what happened after 9/11. Our chamber really felt the burden. But guess what? You know, we sustained. Why? We're the only binational Mexican and U.S. Chamber of Commerce, Mexican major corporations in U.S. The other side of it, we just finished 2 weeks ago with my good friend and co-chairman of the Congressional Border Issues Conference, U.S.-Mexico, our 15th year, Sylvester Reyes of El Paso and Mike McCoy of Austin. And there, Mayor, as you recall, because we did it with your and with you at Yuma, we bring up to Washington the border mayors, Mexican and U.S. We had San Luis and San Luis Rio Colorado that we honored. And why do we do that? To show the importance of that cross-border cooperation, the new mayors association that's happening. Let's talk about a few other things that really are very critical. NAFTA started the process, and where we are now, $1 billion plus trade between every day between the United States and Mexico. That's 3 to 4 times more than it was 20 years ago, as an example, just before NAFTA. Labor. It always drives me crazy when people say, oh, well, we're going to China, we're offshore. Onshore is both labor costs and security for us. And what do I mean by that? China is no longer the low-cost labor provider. Right. Mexico is actually lower in cost per hour per worker. Maquiladoras, which was a great growth area prior to NAFTA, over 2,000, over a million workers, took a big hit after 9/11. But guess what? They're growing at 15%. They're going from 1,200 to almost 150,000 more new workers in the last 2 years. So, you know, it's starting to recuperate. It's starting to come back. And it's working because many of our firms are right across that border because also of NAFTA and that trade environment. I'll finish by a couple of things. Is the largest component manufacturing and assembly of aerospace in our country is in Querétaro, Mexico. You didn't know that. That's onshoring, that's securing the supply chain and its investment and its jobs in Mexico. What does that all mean? It means remittances are $20 billion a year from Mexican, both illegal and legal workers, sending it back to their country, Mexico, to their families. Tourism is one of the three major largest revenue sources for Mexico. Energy, environment, critical. Why? Canada and Mexico supply about 60% of our needs here in North America for energy and energy independence for the future, to include our own country. So when you look at transportation investment and you look at the seamlessness that we're trying to achieve on the border, we are inextricably combined at the hip, and we will be for the future and to the betterment of ours. There's 50 million Hispanics in this country now. I live, by the way, John, I live in Irving, Texas, which is one of the most real highlights of the CAP program, criminal alien program, mm-hmm. and it's working. So, ladies and gentlemen, I have to tell you, the driver is people, commerce, service across a seamless, workable border that our people here are doing, and the Secretary talked about it, but more importantly, it's economics. That drives it all. Thank you, Joe.
Thanks, everybody. Those are some just opening thoughts. I mean, we're here to think through and discuss this whole idea of a 21st century border, to recognize the progress that's been made and to continue to discuss the challenges ahead. So in that construct, we're going to open it up to all of you. And again, I want to thank this distinguished panel. It's a remarkable group that we have here. So please take advantage of the opportunity, and let's get some questions on the table. Where is the mic, Hillary? Yes, ma'am, right here. And I'll try to, now that the podium's gone, I'll try to swing around.
Maria Pena with FA News Services. This goes back to just following up on your concern that the national media is giving this false perception that the border is not secure or there's chaos there. But I was wondering if you will own up to your part of the responsibility, because hearing after hearing on the Hill, a lot of government officials come and warn about the risk or even some evidence of spillover violence from Mexico. So I was wondering if you have had some responsibility in that as well. And also to John Morton, you know, the administration says that they continue to support and push for the DREAM Act, but the fact is that DREAMers are being deported. So how do you reconcile that situation there? Thank you.
So anyone who wants to jump in, these are open forum. John, why don't you start, and then we'll move to the broader.
I'll just reiterate what the Secretary said on the DREAM Act. Obviously, we were big supporters, big proponents of the DREAM Act, actually, and it didn't pass. And we are in a situation where we cannot suspend federal law as to an entire class of individuals. And so we deal with these cases on a case-by-case basis. I think if you take a look at the record, people that fit within the confines of the DREAM Act, there are, in fact, very, very few deportations of those kinds of individuals. And as the Secretary said, they don't fit within our present priorities. And our priorities are removing criminal offenders, working with CBP to secure the border, focus on recent entrants, and those who game the system. And it ends there. Thank you.
You have somebody over there. Right? Yeah.
Is there anybody else want to comment on the...
Let me kind of pick up on the question that the young lady asked about our responsibility. Our responsibility collectively is to protect our border. Our responsibility is to prevent, to deter, to preempt anything bad from happening. That entails not only doing what we're doing, increasing the safety and security of our borders to the degree that the mayor so adequately described, that it is, in fact, safer than what it's ever been. But we also have a responsibility to consistently and constantly be on the lookout for anything that could happen. That is good, solid law enforcement responsibility and portraying that there is a need to continue that watch, to continue pushing back so that there is no activity on the part of the cartels or the criminal organizations to allow them to even think that they can operate with any level of impunity along our borders. Now, the Secretary has said it, I have said it, the Director has said it, all of us have said it. We have accomplished a lot, but there is more to do. So there has to be that balance. It is a portrayal of reality as it relates to the level of security that exists on that border today, and unfortunately, the reality of what exists south of that border and the reality of having to not only keep it south of that border, but very critically and importantly, do everything that we can with our Mexican partners that are undertaking this heroic effort to help them reduce it also.
Any other thoughts? Yeah, that's okay. I'm happy for the help. Happy for the help.
Hi, Jill Cohen with DuPont. A question for the panel, I guess, in general. And we talked about the drivers of why this is so important, and we've talked about economic drivers for the flow of goods. We've also talked about the security issues, continuing to maintain security. I wondered if you could speak to a growing issue around counterfeiting, both counterfeiting of goods and services, as well as counterfeiting of identifications and, you know, where we're going from the Real ID Act. If any of you can comment on those, I'd appreciate that.
Well, I'll take the first one. I think let me say it this way. American industry and innovation is under assault from organized criminals engaged in counterfeiting. This is not a minor concern. It's a major concern. Many of our most important industries are facing very, very significant threats. The pharmaceutical industry, the entertainment industry, just to give you a sense of it. And it poses a real danger to the United States in terms of lost innovation, lost jobs, lost revenue. Counterfeiters don't pay health care. They don't pay taxes. They don't particularly care about U.S. workers or the U.S. economy. And in the case of a number of our products that are being counterfeit, there's a direct threat to health and safety. Just think of pharmaceuticals. Think of chemical production. We do cases at intellectual property enforcement. Counterfeiting and piracy is one of the main things that we do as an investigative agency. And we investigate everything from counterfeit toothpaste, counterfeit airbags, counterfeit heart medicine, cancer medicine, psychiatric medicine. It's a real concern. So the good news is that there's a great deal of attention being paid to this issue within the administration. The vice president has taken it up as a personal cause. We have the first intellectual property enforcement coordinator. Our enforcement efforts at ICE are at an absolute all-time high. Our seizures with CBP at the border are at an all-time high. So there's a lot of good developments, but I'll be candid with you. We're just now, I think, as a government, coming to grasp how serious this issue is, and it is going to be with us for quite some time. The level of organized crime behind counterfeiting and piracy is disturbing, so it's going to take a sustained and quite aggressive effort to do something about it.
We got a on this side, we haven't done anybody over here. No, we got, okay, yes, we'll go here. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Jean Butterfield. I'm with the Raven Group. John, on worksite enforcement issues, I think, you know, many of us have welcomed the shift away from the raids that were happening, you know, a few years ago to more focused attention and prioritizing critical infrastructure, egregious employers, violations of wage and hour standards and all of that at the workplace. But when you look through the kind of targets that seem to have been lifted up and gone after, prosecuted, I-9 audits, all of that, many of them seem to be more of the good apple employers, people who are trying to do the right thing, who are trying to comply with the law. And so I wonder, in terms of your own priorities, what kind of work is being done with the Department of Labor to really try to make sure that those priorities are reflected in the enforcement actions that happen, and we really do target the bad apples, the ones who are paying under the table, who are exploiting the workforce, who are creating unsafe working conditions?
Well, a couple of things. First of all, as you may know, Secretary Solis announced yesterday that the Department of Labor and ICE had entered into an agreement in which we would ensure that our respective enforcement efforts are coordinated. And so if there's a Department of Labor worksite investigation, we at ICE are not going to conduct a simultaneous investigation, and we'll let the Department of Labor's wage and hour and OSHA and other investigations go forward, stand down during the pendency of that investigation. Secondly, we do try to target abusive employers. We do try to target the worst of the worst. I think the only part where we would have some difference is that we are trying to create a culture of compliance, and that does mean that we have to not be seen as saying that it's okay not to follow the law if you are paying the minimum wage or above, or your workplace meets OSHA standards. No, it's not okay. You have to follow the law. As the Secretary said, we're trying to create a culture of compliance across the U.S. Industry as a whole. We have increased the number of our audits substantially, and I think some of the sort of reports in the media and the attention being paid to it is a reflection of that increase, and now we are reaching companies like Chipotle as a case that has gotten a lot of attention, and not just sort of smaller or very localized employers as had been done in the past. And we just had a big announcement with Tyson's Foods, which is a very large employer, to join Image. I mean, I'll tell you, what we're trying to do is encourage as much as we can voluntary compliance. If we don't have to send agents on knocking on the door, that's a good result. We want people to be able to comply. That's where E-Verify comes into play, why it's such an important part of worksite enforcement. You know, we need a way for employers to be able to easily and accurately ensure that the people that are working for them have work authorization, leaving our enforcement resources at ICE for those that narrow class of employers that is knowingly violating the law on a grand scale or in an abusive manner.
If I can just jump in, Ali, there's been a lot of investment made in trying to modernize the visa system in the U.S. Anyone who's dealt with visas or gone through the immigration naturalization process knows that this has not always been the most modern system of all government systems in recent memory. I know that there's been an announcement, for example, recently that people can now track their own process online. Could you, before we go, because we don't have much more time, just recap a little bit for us some of the investments that have been made and how the department is really trying to help make this a much more consumer-friendly process?
Sure. I will very candidly say that the lack of modernity is not necessarily the first complaint that I hear, but let me tackle that. Our agency, USCIS, has been and remains a paper-based agency. And one of the important initiatives that we have underway is to actually move that agency, our agency, into an electronic environment that will not only provide greater access on the part of the customer to the status of cases and to information from our agency, but also enable our agency to collect and use data more efficiently. That is a multi-year project, the first phase of which we will be rolling out at the end of this year. So we're really devoting a considerable amount of resources and attention to it. One of the things that we did at the end of 2009 was redesign our website to make that more user-friendly as a tool of modernity. And so it's an area of tremendous focus on our part. We know that access to information and ease of use of the system is one of the challenges that we face.
Let me look around. You've already got, she's very anxious, but let me see if we can get a couple more other folks. Yes, ma'am, right here. Yes.
Good morning. I'm Deborah Sigmund, founder of Innocence at Risk, protecting women and children from trafficking. Human trafficking is an issue that has not been brought up this morning, and this is a question for the panel, especially Secretary Morton. Knowing that human trafficking is a huge problem for this country and all over the world, over $32 billion for organized crime, and a lot of the activity happens at the border. So can you talk a little bit about the Blue Campaign and what your agents, how you're training your agents to recognize potential victims of women and children?
Hey, John, before you begin, I think we have to let David go. He's got an appointment, and we're running a little late. So just so you can stay on time, David, thank you for being with us today. We're going to continue. We appreciate your...
Thank you for the opportunity.
All right, so we do have a Blue Campaign at the Department of Homeland Security, and it's largely an effort to bring all of the many parts of the department that have authorities and abilities to support the cause in this area together, get them focused on training, outreach, and you know, a sort of coordinated and marshaled effort against the challenge. ICE is the principal component within the department that deals with that, although CIS and Ali to my left have an extremely important role when it comes to some of the benefits. Our investigations are last year were an all-time high on trafficking cases. We do a lot of not only labor and sex trafficking, we would do child sex tourism and child forced labor as well. That our cases are at an all-time high is, you know, in some sense a good sign that the government's really focused on it. It's also a terrible sign because these are the kinds of cases that, unfortunately, a lot of the damage has already been done by the time we get around to investigating. And it's an important deterrence that we're out there. In this country, at least, we get substantial sentences on our trafficking cases. We've had great success in the prosecutions. The real challenge for us is building relationships with like-minded countries. There's a lot of work to be done there, particularly in Asia and some of the other countries where it's a real challenge. I'll tell you, though, things are moving in the right direction. A few years ago, our work in Cambodia was extremely difficult. And through a lot of training and outreach, we now, I can tell you that the Cambodian National Police are every bit a partner in a lot of our cases, and we've had some great success in places like Cambodia and Thailand that we wouldn't have been able to have even just a short 4 or 5 years ago. There are a lot of cultural attitudes that need to be addressed, and unfortunately, as you noted, this is big criminal business. This is organized crime. It is not a mom and pop operation. It's quite sophisticated and quite ruthless, and it takes extensive overseas investigation and an undercover capacity to root it out.
Let me, if I can, just add to that very briefly, because the Blue Campaign is a campaign that the Secretary created and designed and has put a great deal of emphasis and prioritization on. It is a multi-agency effort within the Department of Homeland Security. Customs and Border Protection has a critical role at the border. Their officers have been trained to identify victims of human trafficking or culprits of it. We also have engaged as a department in a significant education campaign to educate individuals outside of the law enforcement community as to how to identify victims. We have a CBP has developed under the leadership of the Secretary what they call a shoe card, which is a card that provides information not only on how to identify a victim, but also the redress that is available, the toll-free number to call. John has spoken about ICE's role. We at USCIS have a increasingly resourced unit in our Vermont Service Center dedicated to the issuance of visas to victims of human trafficking, and for the first time ever in 2010, we reached the cap of 10,000 visas. This is a multi-agency effort. We also have collaborated very closely with state and local law enforcement, which are often the first responders and the people on the ground who observe in the first instance a victim or the victimization of people. And we have established a rigorous protocol for the training and collaborative law enforcement work in this important area. It's an area of tremendous focus led by the Secretary.
So what I want to do, because we're running out of time, is just take three very quick questions. We're going to answer all of them together, and so everyone will get a chance on our panel to get a last bite at the apple or whatever else they'd like to weigh in on. So do we have any over here? Anybody over here? Okay, go ahead. Hey, Rob.
Ben Johnson with the American Immigration Council. So it seems to me this message of the border is open for business is a message that can and should be applied to the immigration system writ large. You know, you alluded to the fact that many people who go through our immigration system really go through with a feeling that sort of they're being treated like they are a potential terrorist. That's horrible for business in terms of tourism. It's horrible in terms of the transparency that many high-skilled immigrants coming to the United States or any immigrants coming to come here legally, you know, trying to run that gauntlet of the immigration system is a real challenge if enforcement continues to be the only thing that we talk about in the immigration context, and that some broader discussion about discretion. It will be applied where it exists, and that we will understand that compliance is a goal. We will work with people to comply with the system rather than trying to identify fraud and treat everybody like a potential terrorist. Again, I just think this is a conversation that ought to be applied beyond the border to the immigration system writ large.
Anything in the middle? Yes, sir. You already got your question.
My question is more specifically to Alan, since you haven't had any questions yet. You mentioned, Yuma, you have a comprehensive approach to border security. Could you maybe go into a little bit more detail as to what that is? And you also mentioned your dealings with your state legislature and your state government. And in a perfect world, what type of either reforms or government, state government aid would you like to see from Phoenix?
Bless you.
Anything on this side? Yes, sir. We'll end up, wrap up with this.
My question is for members of the administration. I just want to know if you think that Mexican drug cartels should be designated by the federal government as foreign terrorist organizations.
That's a fun one. And so thank you. And I just open it up for anyone who'd like to jump in. Just go right in. Alan, why don't we start with Alan? Go ahead, Alan.
Well, thank you. One of the things that Yuma, Arizona has going for it is, when I say comprehensive, all levels of all law enforcement work together. We respond. We have intergovernmental memorandums of understanding. We help respond a lot of the issues. In fact, every issue relative to border security, immigration, happens in Yuma, Arizona. And I think it's important to draw a distinction between cross-border traffic, cross-border trade, and immigration. Immigration is a federal issue. I welcome many people who we've had naturalization ceremonies in our city hall, and no one has a problem with becoming a naturalized citizen. In fact, that's what we encourage, working through the system. Is the system slow as a snail's pace? Absolutely. And at the federal level, do they need to address the volume of people that are naturalized? Absolutely. But they're going to have to do that at the natural level, at the national level. Oftentimes, our police department, our sheriff's department, are the first responders when it comes to human trafficking. And it's become so blurred now that human trafficking has become incorporated into the drug trafficking. Young people are being not only recruited, because there's not much opportunity for a living in Mexico, certainly, so they're being recruited and then being held hostage. And the word terrorism came up just a second ago. When families are threatened, when the families of police officers in Mexico and mayors in Mexico are being threatened with their lives if those people don't succumb and obey the drug cartels, I don't know what else you would call it. Those families are terrorized. Whether they're a terrorist organization is open for discussion. But to act certainly terrorizes many families. More than 30,000 people have been murdered in Mexico simply due to the drug cartel violence. That country and entire communities are being held hostage by drug cartels and owned by drug cartels, a $40 billion business. I don't know how you could classify it as anything else, honestly. It has to be addressed. The concern of people along the border and others around the country is the spillover. And once again, our law enforcement agencies tend to be the first responders, or at least called upon to assist many, many times. A van full of 12 or 15 people has an accident on Yuma Proving Ground. We're the ones who are going to respond first. And secondary to that are the federal agencies. So we need that collaborative effort. We need that support. We need that funding. The Stone Garden funding absolutely has helped our communities deal with this. What about the incarceration cost to our communities and to the state of Arizona? The state is broke. That's all there is to it. And now the legislature, our legislature, is considering forcing those incarceration costs down on the counties. and the city. So we're running out of options. We're running out of choices. So we want to make sure that this discussion stays at the forefront at the federal level, and I think Secretary Napolitano is open to that. The level of communication is very good, and so that's the biggest focus of my effort here, is to make sure that the story gets told. The more business, good legitimate business that we bring to our communities, and the legitimate business that Mexico has in their communities, the greater the opportunity for the negative to be pushed out. People have jobs, the economy rises, and we don't have to resort to under the radar business and black market activities and some of the other negative elements. So, hope that answered your question.
John, Ali, anything else you'd like to?
I can follow up, Ben, on your point. Was that a point directed to me or all of us? to all of us. Yeah, and I think your point was that we tend to focus on the fraud and other issues of why not, as opposed to why yes. Is that a fair encapsulation of your point? I think I candidly, I disagree with it. I don't think that we focus on our fraud efforts, our anti-fraud efforts, to the exclusion of our welcoming and embracing efforts. I think that when I champion our welcoming and embracing efforts, it doesn't seem to garner as much attention as when I focus on our anti-fraud efforts. And the question is raised, why am I speaking of our anti-fraud efforts when I am not championing other aspects of carrying forward our nation's history and obligation? So I would say that it is, I would just disagree.
John, any last thoughts?
Just also to Ben's point, a tremendous amount of discretion is exercised every day. Look at ICE. We remove a little bit less than 400,000 people a year. Even at the lowest estimate, there are 11 million people in the year that, as a statutory matter, we're charged with identifying and removing if they're here unlawfully. You know, that's less than 4% of the people who are here unlawfully on a given day. We have a very clear set of priorities. Anybody can go look at them. They're not a secret. We exercise case-by-case discretion every day. We have to. We are not appropriated the resources to do anything else. I also happen to think it's good policy. And I think your real point just goes to the need for a broader discussion in this country about the need for comprehensive immigration reform, and that no one disagrees with that. But I do think that the enforcement efforts, as Ali noted, do tend to get a lot of the attention. There are a lot of efforts underway to have good, sensible government in the absence of comprehensive immigration reform. While stating at the same time very candidly that we think that that is the way to go and necessary. I'm the head of immigration enforcement for the country, and I'm an open supporter of immigration reform. Take it from me. I don't believe an enforcement-only solution is going to get us to the national resolution that we need, and we desperately need it. ICE is in a tough spot institutionally, presiding over a fault line in the American conscience right now on immigration, as we struggle, as the Secretary said, with great passions on both sides. Good people on both sides have different views of this. And I think, everyone recognizes that we need a different system than the one that we have now. The devil is in the details, and in getting there, to a consensus that all of us can live with, and that we can get legislative resolution, because so much of this is a matter of law. And we need to continue to advocate for those things. And in the meantime, Ali and me and others, we're going to enforce the laws the best we can with the resources that we're provided and using common sense and good judgment.
I know the mayor wanted to jump in with a quick thought on that.
Well, I want to say one more thing before we leave here today. I want everyone to understand that the different elements in a community, sheriff's department, police department, mayor's, chamber of commerce, we all have different roles. As the mayor of Yuma, I have a broad scope of interest in the community. But a sheriff has a law enforcement interest. And there's only 15 counties in Arizona. 15. Many states have. Iowa has 99 counties, and they're very small. So the demographics and the geographic area that they cover is very different than it is in many other parts of the country. And they are charged with enforcing the law. If you've got an area that has a high traffic area and everyone's speeding, well, obviously the law enforcement is going to target that area with the speed trap and reduce that traffic and get that speed down. Well, if there's a high traffic of drugs flowing through a particular area, it would be logical for the sheriff's department, who's charged with law enforcement, to be aggressive in those areas. And that's what they're supposed to do. That's what they're being paid to do. They're outgunned. They're outmanned. They're underfunded for the most part. Counties can't simply bear that cost alone. So they tend to get a bit of a bad rap simply for doing their job. Now, are they, some of them, a little more flamboyant and loud and vocal than others? Absolutely. That's the way it is. It is an elected position in Arizona. The same thing goes with police departments. Only those are municipal departments, but they are charged with a specific role. And I think I just wanted to make sure people understand that. And it's a challenge for communities. Sometimes they have conflicting ideas about who should be doing what, but we have to work through those and get to an understanding of whose job it is to do what. Thank you, Simon.
Sure, Al.
Simon, I'll make it sweet and short. The border has two sides to it. First of all, the Mexican government and the mayors along the border are engaged. So this is not a one-sided question that some of you may have in your mind. Secondly, from the business perspective, the economic and investment drivers are very, very evident. Mexico has recovered faster than we have from their economic impact. And more importantly, when you look at that, you will also see that in the last 2 years, they've had the perfect storm, H1N1 virus, floods, earthquakes, I mean, you name it. So, but they've recovered, and the resiliency on the southern part of our border. Final comment. The Mexican government is gauged on trying to mirror what's on our side of the border on their side of the border, and that's with technologies, non-intrusive inspection equipment, all kinds of things to really work with CBP. So I'll just want to leave you with a positive note that on the Mexican side, working with us, it is working.
So I want to thank the esteemed panelists. I want to thank all of you and just close with three very brief thoughts. First is that if you'd like to continue this conversation, we're going to be gathering again in this building on April 11th for a major forum we're doing on U.S.-Latin American relations. We'll be keynote speakers include Bill Richardson and Arturo Saracan and Dan Restrepo from the White House, and we'll be featuring a discussion between the mayors of Nogales, Sonora, Mexico, and the mayor of Nogales, Arizona, colleagues of our Mayor Krieger here today, continuing a look at this 21st century border. Second is that I do think that, as I said in the very beginning, we're in the very early stages of reimagining what our relationship with Mexico and Latin America can be in the United States, and I think that the vision encapsulated in this idea of a 21st century border is still nascent. It's only really a year old in terms of our two governments sort of embracing this new vision. It's comprehensive.
It's trade related. It's dynamic. It's full. It's a glass half full vision and not a glass half empty vision. And I think it's still, we are still all trying to understand it and operate under this new understanding of what's possible between our two countries. And I really want to applaud this administration and President Calderon's administration for having really done heavy lifting in imagining how this can all continue to get better in the 21st century under the new realities that both of our countries face. And finally, I think just to end on a note of sort of this idea that there are challenges ahead, and two that I just want to comment on. First, simply put, you know, what we have demonstrated, I hope, today, and what we'll continue to demonstrate, is that in what was the three-legged stool of the immigration reform strategy that John McCain and Ted Kennedy came up with in 2005, was three pieces, right? We had to make progress on border enforcement and workplace enforcement. We had to deal with future flow, and we have to manage successfully the legalization of the undocumented population. That was the immigration reform strategy. We have demonstrated clearly that we have made substantial, significant progress on the first one. It is time to now start for Congress to start to move on parts two and three to begin to complete the vision that was laid out by John McCain and Ted Kennedy back in 2005. The argument that has been made by some that no progress can be made until the border is secure, I think, has been rendered moot by the conversation that we're hearing today. It is no longer an effective attack on the immigration reform strategy, because this government, along with their Mexican counterparts and local law enforcement and mayors, have shown that we can manage the border successfully. And this is a critical national priority. Second is that all of this is threatened right now by substantial budgetary cuts that are being proposed by Congress. Amazingly, after all the success that you heard today, and it is demonstrable and real, and every possible metric has shown that we've been able to improve the border security over the last few years, after this demonstrable success, there are substantial, significant budget cuts that are being proposed by the House right now. If those go through, we could see an enormous setback on the progress that's been made. And I hope those for all of you, as we leave here, of the work that is still undone, is to get immigration reform done in all of its complexity in the next few years, and to ensure that the progress has been made, the investments that have been made that have been smart, strategic, successful, continue and perhaps even increase, Mayor, in the days ahead. Thank you all for being here. We hope to see you back here on April 11th, and thanks to our esteemed panelists again.